Hello there. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone going today? Yeah? Look at this. You can see my stupid face. How great is it? No, it's great. No mandate, right? It was good. But if you do feel like you need to wear it for your own safety and for your own health, please feel free. You are not forced to do it. But good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Good? Yeah, it's good. A special welcome to you guys if you are online today, a warm welcome. If you have little ones with you today you need to take care of at any time, you need to slip out of the service, we do have the parent retreat just through the Flynn Room here. And if you are new, this is your first time here, a special welcome to you guys. We would love to get to know you more. If you are new, complimentary coffee, right? Free. Or a coffee cart, like real coffee, like not, you know, instant, if that's your thing. But no, we would love to get to know you over a cup of coffee. And also, if you would love to go to the welcome studio just through the foyer outside, we would love to get to know you more. The best way to keep in touch with us is subscribing to our church email and our e-news. I always get that wrong. I always want to say emu in my head. But no, our church e-news and our email and on our Facebook page. That's where all of our notices go through and the best way we can communicate with you guys. Now, a little tidbit of what's happening in the next week. Tomorrow night, we have our church-wide whole tribe prayer meeting. Tomorrow, Monday night, 7 p.m. downstairs. That's going to be awesome. I encourage you guys to come along if you can. It is going to be really, really great. Prayer is something that's part of our lifestyle, part of being a follower of Christ. And it's really personal, and I think it's amazing. So now we're going to take 2 minutes just to check in. And if you're online, you will have a little button that says check in, or QR code will come up on the screen, which you can scan. And just let us know that you're here today and that you can give us your prayer notifications or anything that is going on in your life. And if there'll be an option to give as well. If you're inside today and you give by cash, we will have little letterboxes on the way out as well. So we'll just do that now for 2 minutes. Have fun. When I testified of your great love, well, I was a soul on fire, there was no doubt. Bible believing, saved and washed in the blood. But it was until I stumbled and made my mistakes that I could know in my soul how amazing was grace. You brought me blessings out of a tragedy.
Thank you, everyone, for taking the time to do that. Thank you for letting us know that you're here and sharing all of those prayer requests with us. I'm just so excited. I'm really so excited to have everyone here and to be able to actually hear your voices. I don't know if you know, but when you're up here, you can hear such a difference when people don't have to be wearing masks. So I'm really excited to hear everyone singing and worshiping God this morning. So we are going to actually sing a song this morning about freedom, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So I would encourage you to stand up for those of you here in person and sing out loud. And those of you online, I would encourage you to do that too. So let's join together as we get to worship our God.
The dark. Lord, we want to thank you that you're here with us this morning. Lord, we want to honor your presence by giving you all of our attention. And Lord, we pray that as we continue to meet, that you would make your presence even more known to each and every one of us. Whatever our week has looked like, may we know your presence with us right now. And Lord, we ask that you would just prepare our hearts as we gather around this communion table. Lord, would you open us up afresh to the wonder of your gift, that you are the gift of great price. Your kingdom is the great gift of great prize. And Lord, we prepare our hearts now as we remember who you are and what you've done, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Please take a seat. Good morning. My name is Adam and I'm the lead pastor here at Real Life. And I want to add my welcome to Johan's earlier. It is great to see your faces. So nice. But if you could just do this for me so I could recognize who you are. I'm like, because we kind of forgotten. But it's a lovely season that we're in as we begin to transition out of this time. And of course, as Johan said, if you still feel like more comfortable to wear a mask, that is totally fine. We totally understand that. And you may shift on that over the coming weeks, depending on how you're going. So that is all good. We're just so glad that we could be together today because we're better together. So can I just say up front, if you look around and you think, oh, there's someone, so I haven't seen them for a while, get on the phone this afternoon and make a phone call to them and say, hey, I missed you today. It'd be great to see you. Let's invite our church back, hey? Let's invite our church back. Great to have you with us online as well. And we pray that you are doing well. We're about to share in the communion meal. And it's a really timely thing that we are doing as we are at the front end or the first week of the season of Lent, which is a season of preparation for people on the road to celebrating Easter in about 40 days' time. And so many of you may have started that on Wednesday. You might not have, and that's okay. Depending on your background, it was Ash Wednesday or it was just Wednesday. And that's okay. But if you want to engage in the season of Lent, just this week we sent out some resources to encourage you, if you like. And Lent is a time that started, you know, the early Christians in the first few centuries did not do Lent. It was not a thing. You don't find it in the Bible. It was a tradition that formed about 325 years later. And it was a time where people would remember Jesus' 40 days of fasting in preparation to begin his ministry that would culminate in the events of Easter, which strangely enough, we also celebrate when we gather around the communion table every time. We remember all that that meant. And it is a time in Lent where historically people have fasted, either physically fasted or given something up. But as a church, we want to frame this a little bit differently this year. We'd like you, in amongst whatever else you might be doing for Lent, to focus on a particular thing. And as we prepare for the communion meal together, I just wanted to share with you this account of an engagement with Jesus that one of the teachers of the law, the Pharisees, had with Jesus during his ministry. And we find it in Mark chapter 12. It says, one of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. These are people with Jesus, some of the other people that were around. And noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer as they debated with him, he asked them, of all the commandments, which is the most important? And Jesus replied, the most important one, answered Jesus, is hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. In other words, with everything you are, love the Lord. And the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. And it strikes me as we come around this communion table, where in a moment we will partake of the bread, which is for us a symbol of Jesus' body given for us, broken for us on that cross. And we will share in the juice, which for us is symbolic of his blood poured out as a sacrifice for us, a healing, atoning sacrifice for us, willingly given that we might be made right with God, that the price that we would have paid, he pays for us. That as we think about that, it strikes me that Jesus was doing exactly what he said in these commandments. He was following them. He was loving the Lord his God with everything he was. He literally sacrificed himself under the will of the Father who loved not only his Son, but all his creation and longed for all to be in relationship with him. And similarly, he was loving his neighbor as himself in that he was doing what was necessary for each of us to know what it is to be loved by God. So even as he loved himself, Jesus, Son of God, he was loving us in giving his life for us. He was literally walking out these commandments. My friends, before we share in this meal and remember that and celebrate that afresh, this Lent, my heart and encouragement for each of us at Real Life is that we would similarly sacrifice in loving the Lord our God with everything we have and loving our neighbor as ourselves. That what you might give up is some time, perhaps daily or every couple of days, for a neighbor who's been impacted by the events of the last week. Most of us know someone or a family or people somewhere that are cleaning up after the flood, or who have issues after the flood, or who may have any other kind of challenge. My fast for you this Lent would be to fast some time to give to loving a neighbor, either within our church community or beyond. And you don't have to do it on your own. You could let someone else in the church know, hey, I've got this people I know, they need some help. Come and join me with this, and you can celebrate Lent together as you go and love the Lord your God with everything you have and love your neighbor as yourself. Sound good? In this journey towards Easter. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took some bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body given for you. Eat this and remember me. And likewise, he took the cup and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant made in my blood. Drink this and remember me. And with his closest friends, they shared in a meal that would become a symbol, a practice, a sacrament for us over 2,000 years later. A reminder that your sins are forgiven. There is freedom in Christ, bought for you, not through your own strength, but by the grace of God, a grace that knows no bounds. Our table here at Real Life is an open table, which means anyone can share in this meal. You don't have to be a member of this church. You just need to love Jesus a little bit and want to love him more. And whatever you do, we just ask that whether you're not even sure where you stand with all of that, that you are welcome to participate with a sense of respect. And in this season, just before we get to it, we have these little items. And if you're visiting today for the first time, in a moment, you'll rip off the plastic. Some of you are already doing it, and that's fine. You'll rip off the plastic to access the wafer, and then you can peel off the foil to drink the juice. But before we do that, people of God, before we share in these gifts of God for the people of God, let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you for this gift. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you that you loved the Lord our God so much with everything you had that you were willing to go to the cross for us because you also loved your neighbor as yourself. And Lord, we long to do likewise. Lord, out of the grace that we've experienced. And so, Lord, we pray that we might know afresh your grace, your love, and your forgiveness this morning. Lord, whether we're online at home or whether we're here in the room, may we have a sense of your Spirit leading us and identifying that sin which interferes with our walk with you, because Lord, we want to repent and turn aside from that in the great joy of knowing that forgiveness is ours and we are assured of it, that you love us and we're right with you. Lord, would you bless this bread and this juice? May it be for us a spiritual, physical reminder of your body and your blood broken and poured out for us. And Lord, in sharing this meal, we just affirm this. We love you. You are good. So I invite you to peel off the plastic and to eat the wafer, body of Christ given for you. I invite you, as you're ready, to drink the cup together, the blood of Christ poured out for the forgiveness of sins. We're going to spend some more time in prayer. We're going to pray for healing. We're in a time where there's much need for healing. So I invite you to join with me as we pray. Lord, we invite you, Lord, to come and bring healing where healing is needed. Lord, we pray for those gathered here in the room or online. We pray that you might let your healing power flow, because by your wounds we're healed. There's power in the blood of Jesus. And so we pray and speak healing over each and every person gathered. Healing of bones, healing of ligaments, healing of muscle, healing of wounds. Lord, we speak it out in Jesus' name. Why don't you say that with me? In Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray for healing for those who have emotional need for being made whole, or psychological or mental need for being made whole, or spiritual need for being made whole. We pray healing now. We speak it in Jesus' name. Lord, we want to pray for healing for our community and the whole region of Southeast Queensland impacted by the flooding. Lord, we pray for families who've been displaced from homes that have been damaged or destroyed. Lord, we pray for those who've lost essential items like fridges and bedding and things like that, furniture that's kind of necessary just to do life. Lord, we pray for healing. We pray that there would be provision. And in this season of Lent, Lord, may you help us to be that provision. Lord, give us eyes to see, that we might be a part of your healing work in our community. And Lord, we pray for churches all across the region. We know some have been impacted by the flooding and they'll have to clean up and reset and do all of that work. And we pray your blessing on that process. But also we pray for church communities all across the region of Southeast Queensland, that they might be a shining light for the community in this time. Lord, would you let healing flow? And likewise, Lord, right now we pray for healing in Ukraine. Lord, we pray for peace from the war. Lord, we've been praying for this over the last few weeks, and we've seen, unfortunately, this circumstance unfold. And we don't know all the details, we don't know all the politics, but Lord, we just know that you long for peace and wholeness, and we pray for safety for those who are caught in the midst of it all. We pray for those who have been displaced, the million people who have fled into Poland and other nations. We pray that you would bring healing to that nation, Lord God. We pray that justice would prevail. We pray, Lord, for children that you would watch over them who are growing up in a season that they never ever should experience in their life. And we pray for the protection of human life in the conflict. Lord, we pray that you would bring a conviction of heart to the people that need it to bring peace. We pray for Vladimir Putin, and we acknowledge that you love him. May he know your love. May you impact him this week. In Jesus' name. Lord, we love you. We're so glad that we're able to worship you. We're so glad that you're here. Lord, we pray again, continue to make your presence known in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, we're going to release our kids out to their Kids Life program. Bless your kids as you go. And the team's going to continue to lead us in worship. Thank you, team.
Why don't you stand with us as we continue to sing and worship our God? Sing, Your Grace Is Enough.
Your grace is enough, more than I need. At your word I will believe. I wait for you. Draw near again. Let your spirit.
Lord, we just come to you now. And we bring all that we are to you, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that you would search our hearts. If there is anything that you've been wanting to talk to us about for a while, or something that needs to be changed, or that we need to bring to you, God, we just ask that you would do that now. Lord, we are open vessels for you. We ask that you speak to us, Jesus. Sing, "Here's My Heart."
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
Sing that again. Here's my heart.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Yes, God, speak.
Speak what is true. 'Cause I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure.
You are so good, and you are so worthy of all that we are, God. Yes, Lord, we give it to you. Yes, God. Let's sing you one more. do declare that you are more than enough. Lord, we declare that over every circumstance, over every physical, emotional, mental, financial, relational, over every challenge, over every heartbreak, over every circumstance, Lord, we declare that you are more than enough. And so, God, we just give ourselves of you today, and we just ask that you would be everything for us. That you'd fill our hearts with this sense of peace and safety and calmness, knowing who you are, God. And not just knowing in our heads, but knowing in our hearts that you are more than enough, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We pray these things in your mighty name. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to invite Adam. He's going to share with us this morning.
The only perfect human being ever to walk the planet was the Son of God. His name is Jesus. And after 3 years of ministry, of disturbing the status quo, of ripping off the illusion that religion would be the answer, he was wrongly accused, wrongly convicted, and sent to die on a cross. Does that seem right to you? So in the midst of this, having been flogged and whipped and punished in a crown of thorns thrust upon his head, suffering in pain physically, the sheer weight of the sin of humanity on his shoulders, and he goes to the cross and he is nailed there. And on one side he has a criminal who is accusing him as well and ridiculing him, and on the other side he has another criminal who is starting to catch a glimpse of who he is and what's going on. And in the midst of that, we see one of the most profound acts of love that you or I will ever see. I mean, love is Jesus on the cross, right? As we continue this series, love is, we could just say that love is Jesus on the cross. But in the midst of that, we see this profound response. Just understand the scenario of what's going on here. He is nailed to a cross. And the pain of nails piercing his flesh is only part of it. In the midst of all of that discomfort, we see this unfold. When they came to the place called the Skull, which is this hill on which they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. In the midst of all of that, Jesus, in all of that pain and discomfort, looks down on those who've done it to him and says, "Father, forgive them, because they don't really know what they're doing." I have to say to you, I don't know that I'd have been capable of uttering that, let alone thinking it or even remotely feeling it. Because my response typically, and I'm sure I'm not alone, is, "Oh, you hurt me, you should pay." Isn't that it? Let's be honest now, come on. Saints that we are here, ascended in great maturity. I have to be honest, even if it's I've done it to myself, someone has to pay. Hammer my thumb, oh, hammer, chuck the hammer, it's the hammer's fault. Couldn't be my aim. I'm not quite as bad as that, although I've had my moments. I'm sure you have too. Jesus, in the midst of all of that unjust suffering, says, "Lord, forgive them." In 1 Corinthians 13, we see this definition of love that we've based this series out of, that we're journeying through, called Love Is. And in chapter 13, verses 4 and 5, we read, "Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. My friends, love is forgiving. Love is forgiving. They are not separated. Love is forgiving. And forgiving is to express love. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, this apostle Peter, who was one of Jesus' closest followers, he says to these people that he's writing to, he says, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. In other words, love enables forgiveness to flow. Love means that sins can be done set aside and no longer interrupt a relationship. Peter's essentially saying love is forgiving. Now, right up front, I want to say this. When we talk about forgiveness, it can be challenging. So let me just say right up front, forgiveness does not mean that whatever happened to you was okay. Forgiveness does not mean you have to remain in a place where you continue to suffer under the hands of someone else. That's not what forgiveness means. And that's not what we're saying today. What I am saying, though, is that love is forgiving. And love is no more a feeling than forgiving is. The kind of love we're talking about is not love you feel, it's love you choose. And forgiving is the same. Forgiveness is not a feeling, it's a choice. And if we choose it long enough, some feelings might follow. The same happens with love. We choose to love. And then maybe some feelings will flow that follow that. Now, God has always been like this. God has always been a forgiving God. This God of love has always been like this. This is not new in Jesus. It's not something that we just discovered when Jesus sat his friends around the table and broke bread with them and drank wine and said, this is what it's going to be like now. There's now forgiveness for you, for people. God has always been like this. He's always expressed love in part through his forgiveness of those whom he loves, those who've wronged him, those who've sinned or broken relationship with him. In fact, in his book, Gentle and Lowly, which Claire quoted from last week, is a great book and we'd encourage people to read. Dane Ortlund, the author, he says this. He says, the high point of Jeremiah's prophecies is chapters 30 to 33. So Jeremiah was a prophet during what's called the exile. So God's people, Israel, have been taken over by the nation of Babylon, and Babylon had dispersed them all over their own kingdom, removed them. So they're now under a dictatorship. And this word comes to God's people through Jeremiah the prophet. And the high point of some of his prophecies is chapters 30 to 33. Dane Ortlund says, scholars call this the book of consolation because he reveals to his people in these chapters his final response to their sinfulness and it is not what they deserve. So in these chapters, God reveals what he's going to do to those who've sinned. And it says this, expecting judgment, he surprises them with comfort. Why? Because he has pulled them, that's Israel, his people, into his heart, and they cannot sin their way out of it. I have loved you with an everlasting love, he assures them. These are God's words to his people. He has pulled his people into his heart, and they cannot sin their way out of his heart. He's always been like this. How cool is that? You are in God's heart, and you cannot sin your way out of it. His forgiveness is so profound. His forgiveness is as boundless as his love, and his love knows no end. So if you are here online or in the room, you are the recipient of God's love expressed in his forgiveness for you, no matter what you've done. No matter what you've done. No matter what you've done. And he's always been like this. He's drawn you into his heart. You can't sin your way out of God's heart. And just so you know, that when God does this work through Christ on the cross, his forgiveness is expressed and how complete it is. Dane Ortlund wonderfully puts it like this. Let's continue with what he has to say in another part of his book. God's forgiving, redeeming, restoring touch reaches down into the darkest crevices of our souls, those places where we are most ashamed, most defeated. More than this, those crevices of sin are themselves the places where Christ loves us the most. in your dark, sinful crevices of your soul. His heart willingly goes there. His heart is most strongly drawn there. He knows us to the uttermost, and he saves us to the uttermost because his heart is drawn out to us to the uttermost. There's no half measures with God. His love and his forgiveness is absolute. We cannot sin our way out of his tender care. This is awesome news. It's a cause to relax, to rest, and sit and think, the God of the universe loves me, and because he loves me, I'm forgiven. I owe him nothing for all the things I've done that might be considered some kind of rebellion toward him, some kind of message to him that says, I don't need you, I don't want you, I want to live my own way. I know better than you, God. That's a strange thing to say, isn't it? Because it's like saying, I am God. I know better than you, God. Yeah. He says, well, yep, you've behaved like that, but you can't break my love for you. It's so absolute. In fact, in the fullness of Christ and his death and resurrection, something we remembered around the communion table just a little earlier, we see it demonstrated in the Apostle Paul, this great Christian first century leader. He had this to say about it in his letter to the Romans in chapter 5. You see, at just the right time, while we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Notice that. He didn't die for the well put together. He didn't die for the well behaved. He didn't die for the people who have a veneer of having it all together, but when they're really honest and look in the mirror, they know underneath it's not quite all there. By the way, I was referring to us when I said that. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. His love expressed in forgiveness of sin. And we owe him nothing. The great Christian leader, Charles Spurgeon, had this to say, our sins are gone. He cast them into his own tomb and they are buried there, never to have a resurrection. In God's view, that sin which once stained us is never being held against you ever again. Can you just breathe a sigh of relief? Because here's the thing. I think many of us know this, but we live our lives forgetting it here. Yeah? Here is the reality. We are forgiven because God loves us. Love is forgiving. But something then is then expected of us or required of us or encouraged of us by God himself. For if we are loved through forgiveness, then we are to forgive others. And that's where the really hard work starts. Can I put to you this? That forgiving is freeing others. It's freeing others. It's actually liberating others. The same freedom we experience from God in his love expressed to us through forgiving our sins, his love demonstrated on the cross, for us to forgive others is to free them in their context of relationship with us, just as we are made free in our relationship with God. And as I mentioned, that can be a bit of a challenging. Again, Charles Spurgeon, he said this, the Lord is very ready to forgive. Christians are unmerciful sometimes, but not so the Master. Working this out can be a challenge, right? Because hurting hurts. Being grieved hurts, and we have to process that, and we have to do something with that. And I'm not for a second suggesting that we shouldn't do the work to process what it means to be grieved or to process our hurt or to process our harm. Those are important steps to take on a journey of forgiveness. But we are commended, compelled, instructed to forgive one another, to free others, to release them from what they owe us for what they've done to us. Now, I sat with a group of students from Calvary who were doing an Alpha course at the moment. And a question was put as part of the discussion that was around this whole area of sin and forgiveness. And it was fascinating to listen to these students, just recognizing that not every student there is necessarily a student with a personal faith. They're all on a journey. And it's one of the beautiful things about our college. And listening to their discussion and engaging with them in it and realizing that some of them believed, or in their processing at that time, were convinced that for forgiveness to happen, repentance had to happen on the other side. The other person needed to know they'd done something wrong and have sought the forgiveness. And that was the only way forgiveness could flow. And I think sometimes that's how we behave. Unless they're sorry, I'm not forgiving them. But Jesus expresses God's forgiveness to us. He didn't wait for us to be sorry. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Not when we were sorry. Not when we even realized we were sinners. And so we are to emulate this, as challenging as it can be, this divine forgiveness, this divine love, is to embody us, not when the other person waits. We are to free them, whether they know they need freeing or not. That's harder, isn't it? Forgiveness is easier when the other person who's hurt us or behaved in a way to damage us or to insult us or to break relationship with us, when they come and they confess that and they acknowledge what they've done, and even better if they make restitution. They do what they can to make it right. That's a great response, and we should respond like that when we recognize we've done that to other people. But what about when they don't? We're still called to forgive. Forgiving is freeing others from what we believe they owe us. And how can we do this? Because we trust that the God who rules all creation, who is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, Jehovah Jireh, the great provider, that he is able to meet what we believe we have lost in that transaction. Our faith is not in the person to make things right. Our faith is in the living God who rules over all. And in these moments of turmoil, we can take a step back and say, hang on, am I putting my faith in this human being to set things right, or can I actually release them? Because my faith is really in the unshakable God who loves us unconditionally, unendingly, and unshakably. In Colossians, the Apostle Paul, who I mentioned earlier, he writes this, chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, it's you and me, holy and dearly loved, also you and me, clothe yourselves with compassion, with kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, do what? Put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. We could see through this lens that Paul says, when you put on love, the lenses that it comes out, the prism that that's expressed in is in compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. That's the prism of love. That's how love is expressed through the prism of our lives as God pours it into us. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. My friends, when we do this, we free someone else. They no longer owe us. They no longer, whether they knew it or not, they no longer owe us. There's no debt because we've wiped it. The term forgiveness is a financial one. It's in that sense of a financial sense of a debt owed that must be repaid. And to forgive is to say, no, you no longer need to repay it. That is the choice that we make. And we free others. And you might think, Adam, that's so hard. You don't understand how hurt I've been. And look, no, I don't. Any more than you know how hurt I've been in my life at different times. We don't know it all. And this is so challenging, what we're saying. And I feel the weight of it in my own life. And as I prepared this message this week, I sat there and went, where have I not got this right? Because this is not easy. And where have there been times where I've held on to unforgiveness? I've held on to it. I've held it because someone did something wrong by me. And maybe it even wasn't a person. Maybe it was an organization. You know, maybe it was a group of people who never even knew that the decisions they were making would be harmful to me. And having to choose to do this, but here's what I know from my own experience, and maybe you can relate. To hold on to unforgiveness takes a lot more energy than to let go and free the other person. Have you ever noticed it takes a lot more energy to stay angry? Have you noticed? It takes a fair bit, right? I just don't have that much energy. I'm getting lazy in my older age. Well, that's a lot of energy to stay angry. That's a lot of energy to be grumpy. Oh my goodness, there's so much energy required there. In my laziness, I go, well, I just won't do it then. I'll just forgive. I'll work it through and get over it because you know what? So much easier after that. So much lighter. It can be hard yards, but we're called to free others in doing this. And hopefully in our freeing them, they might experience and discover the same love that God has poured into our life. When we forgive others and we free them, we actually invite them to step into the freedom that Christ himself brings in the fullness of forgiveness that can come for all of their sin. My friends, we're called to express a love that is forgiving. And when we forgive, we free others. But do you know what? What I've been talking about just now is also the next part of forgiving, because forgiving is freeing ourselves. Forgiving is freeing ourselves from all of that wasted energy, from holding on to pain where there could be healing instead. In Luke chapter 17, Jesus tells this story to make a point. I want you to follow along with me as we read from verses 3 through to verse 10. And I want you to think about, what does this say? What is Jesus saying about our responsibility when it comes to forgiving others? Jesus says this: if your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. And if they repent, forgive them. And if they sin against you 7 times in a day and 7 times come back to you saying, I repent, you must forgive them. Not you should forgive them. Just note that. You must forgive them. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Isn't this interesting? They see what Jesus has said as really challenging. What you want us to forgive? Just keep in mind that these apostles are Jewish men. And they have grown up in a world that said an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth and you get retribution where you can. Not really fully understanding the heart of God. Increase our faith. And Jesus replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. Suppose one of you has a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Will he say to the servant when he comes in from the field, come along now and sit down to eat? Won't he rather say, prepare my supper, get yourself ready and wait on me while I eat and drink, and after that you may eat and drink? Will he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you've done everything you were told to do, should say, we're unworthy servants. We've only done our duty. We've only done our duty. Think about this. He just talked about the obligation to forgive. And then he kind of spins around, turns cycles around them, and he says, and don't expect to be thanked for offering forgiveness. It's your duty. You're to do this. He's not leaving a lot of room. You are obligated to forgive. This is your duty. As a person in the kingdom of God, forgive. That's harsh, Jesus. Don't you know my pain, Jesus? Oh, yeah, I know my pain. Remember where we started the service? Remember where we started the message? Hanging on a cross, Jesus says, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. It's your duty. Could it be that Jesus' heart here is not simply for the one who would be forgiven, but for the one who would do the forgiving? Could it be that Jesus, being the Son of God, divine and unaware and so intimate with the Holy Spirit and knowing so much the human psyche, could it be that he already knew that 2,000 years later in our time we'd see research that says that people that hang on to bitterness and forgiveness have a greater risk of heart disease? They have a greater risk of mental health issues. They have a greater risk of shortening their lifespan. Did you know that's all true? When we sit with unforgiveness, it harms us. Could it be that Jesus knew this and he says, no, you'll be people who forgive. Because actually, not only is it good for the one who receives it, does it reveal my love and my character and my nature, but it actually is going to bless you. It's your duty. Because the one who loves us and died for us wants you to have a full and abundant life. My friends, forgiving is freeing ourselves. Forgiving is letting go and finding that life and that freedom that he intends for us. Lewis B. Smeads, he was a theologian at Fuller Theological Seminary. He said this: to forgive is to set a prisoner free and discover that the prisoner was you. That actually when we hold unforgiveness, we're actually locking ourselves up. Just keep in mind the other person who's aggrieved us, they may never know they've done it. Or they may never acknowledge that it was an issue. And so if we're waiting for them, We're the one who's actually trapped. We put ourselves in a prison. And when we choose to express love in forgiveness, make that choice, we actually set ourselves free from that prison of unforgiveness. So what interferes with our capacity to forgive? What is it that holds us back? Because it can be challenging, can't it? What holds us back from this? Could it be fear? Fear that maybe things won't get made right in the end? Could it be fear that somehow forgiving them communicates that everything's okay when it's not? Could it be fear that actually stops us from being able to free others and free ourselves in forgiveness, expressing love that way? Could it be a lack of trust that God's bigger still and able to bring restoration to our lives where maybe we've experienced loss as a result of what took place? Because we know that He's the God of immeasurably more. His arms are not too short to meet any need. What is it that holds us back? Could it be that what we need is just more love? Because love expresses itself in forgiveness. Could it be that actually we need to receive more love, let God love us more, that the overflow might be that we're able to live out more love, that the overflow might be that we're able to forgive? Could it be that love is the antidote to unforgiveness? Remember, we said love is a choice. We're not talking about feeling love. We're not talking about chemistry. I've got chemistry with that person. I think I'm in love. We're not talking about love like that. We're talking about the choice we make to love, to value someone. It's a choice. Could it be that the antidote to unforgiveness is actually love? In 1 John 4:18, John says this: there's no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment, and the one who fears is not made perfect in love. Fear has to do with punishment. Either the punishment we think we deserve or the punishment we think others deserve for harming us. But perfect love drives out that fear. My friends, love is forgiving. So this morning, before we move on and enjoy a great time of fellowship out in the courtyard, we want to make space for God to move in us. We want to make space to process forgiveness. Not that in a moment, instantly this morning, everything might be resolved, or that God is able to move hearts and minds like that. He can do that. But that maybe we might make space for God to pour His love into our hearts in greater measure, to enable us to feel afresh, as we gather around the communion table earlier, that sense of His forgiveness for us, and for us to make resolution, to make choices this week, to not choose fear, but to choose forgiveness. To say, I'm going to make a choice to release someone. Might even be someone here. You don't need to go up to them and say, I made a choice to release you this morning, even though you never knew all the dirty stuff you did to me. But anyway, I've released you. Bless you. That's not how that's going down today, right? It might be, I forgive you, Adam, for all the things you've done to our church. Yeah. Thank you, I receive it. All right. Love is forgiving, and we're going to just make room for God to do what He needs to do in us so that we can make those choices. And we're going to ask Him to empower us to keep making that choice, because we might need to keep making it, right? We don't want to keep making it. And in doing that, we're going to make space for Him to free us and to free others, that we might leave today lighter than we came in. How does that sound? So let's take some time to pray. Why don't you join with me as we do that? Lord, we acknowledge that Your love of us is so deep and so profound, and it expresses itself in Your unfathomable forgiveness of our sin. And Lord, we just come to You and thank You for that forgiveness. and ask that even right now, you might pour out your love into our hearts in greater measure. While we're in this attitude of prayer, I'd invite you, you might like to physically posture yourself in a posture of receiving, because you want to receive that love. And Lord, we ask as you pour out a fresh revelation for us of your love by your Spirit, that it might drive out the fear that we've held. The fear that we've held that the pain that we've experienced at the hands of other people, whether it's small or great, that it might not ever be resolved, or that you might not ever make it right, but we just choose to trust you, Jesus. We trust you that you can make it right. You can do this. So Holy Spirit, let your love fall in fresh measure this morning. Let it sweep away the fear. Fill us with faith afresh right now in these moments. We receive it, Lord. We thank you. And as we receive it, Lord, help us to see where we have harbored unforgiveness toward others. There might be specific circumstances. Lord, would you just put your heavenly finger on those in our hearts and minds right now? And Lord, we ask that you would give us the courage and the love to set those people free in forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness of us. Lord, we choose this morning to forgive those who've aggrieved us, to show love to them. Lord, you even told us we should love our enemy. Lord, we express love to them, not in a fluffy kind of love, but in a choice to forgive, which in itself is an act of love. Lord, we say they don't owe us now. Lord, we pray that you would give us the grace and the strength to make that choice tomorrow if we need to make it again tomorrow. And the next day and the day after that. Lord, lead us into this freedom that your love brings, because your love is forgiveness. It's forgiving. And we just thank you for that. Lord, would you let freedom flow? Lord, I pray for freedom for those who've carried unforgiveness for a while. And while the circumstance might not be resolved, Lord, that there might be a freedom to posture for openness to resolution when the time comes, because forgiveness has flowed. Lord, I pray for healing for anyone whom really has felt arrested with bitterness. And we just rebuke bitterness in Jesus' name. Any spirit of bitterness that's formed like a root in the heart of anyone here, Lord, we just rebuke in Jesus' name. We rip that root out in Jesus' name. And we pray freedom and forgiveness. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We thank you, Lord, that you're doing this work in us. And we continue to receive it. Lord, as we just bring our time of prayer to a close, we just want to say, here's our heart. Lord, speak what's true. Lord, we just want to declare afresh that we're yours and that we want to make room for you to work in and through us. Lord, here's our heart, Lord. Lord, this is our song, our meditation, our thought as we go out with the desire to express a love that's forgiving into our day and into our week. Here's our heart, Lord. Here's my heart. Amen. Why don't you stand with us as we sing this song by way of response?
My heart, Lord, is my
Lord, we thank you. We just want to thank you for the work that you've started today in our hearts. And Lord, we just pray that you would help us and give us the strength and the courage to continue to choose love and to choose forgiveness over any other pain or sadness or hurt. But Lord, just be with us and fill us with your Holy Spirit that we might be able to choose love every day. Thank you, God. Yes, God. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, thank you for joining with us this morning, church. Again, we would really encourage you, don't forget that our coffee cart is open. So that means that you can have coffee that's not instant. Unless you prefer instant, that's okay. I'm not judging you outwardly. So feel free to go grab some coffee. Please enjoy fellowship together. And of course, Adam, Claire, and Dan, and everyone, people will be here up front if you do want prayer. So please feel free to come forward. But just enjoy this week. Enjoy having fellowship together and be blessed. Thank you.